My role is I'm the Pōwhānau Connector for the Mid-North region for Ngāti Hini Health Trust. I come from lived experience and I want to share a bit of my story with you guys so that you can, yeah, it's what led me to my role today. So I was an addict for over 20 years. I had a severe addiction and it led me to selling drugs in my community in Dargaville and to maintain my habit. I caused so much bad, like everything bad in my community and people's lives, losing their kids, ending up in jail, crimes that they were committing to feed their habit, like burglaries, aggravated robberies, violent crimes, domestic violence, suicides, the list goes on and on. I could spend the whole day. And I used to justify this by telling myself if they weren't getting it off me, they'd be getting it off someone else. So it didn't really matter. But you can only lie to yourself for so long, and after 20 years I started to get a conscience, and but by that time I was too deep, I was way too deep in, and I couldn't get out. I just didn't know how to get out of it. I didn't just wake up one day and say, right, I'm going to be an addict. Addiction's cunning, and it snuck up on me, and before I knew it, I was an addict. But for the whole 20 years that I used, I 100% believed in my own head that I wasn't an addict. I thought that because I wasn't using my own money to pay for it, I was using other people's money, it made them the addict, not me the addict. Because, you know, you always hear people say, oh, if you become addicted to that meth stuff, you'll lose all your money, you'll lose everything. So, yeah, I thought, oh, no, well, I'm not an addict because I'm not losing my money. Yeah. And then in 2018, I ended up in an operation called Operation Ghost, which is what Shane was talking about. And I ended up in Auckland Women's Prison, sitting in a cell with 44 supply charges of meth. I thought, oh, my life's over, because like each one of those charges had a maximum penalty of life imprisonment. And I thought, oh my God, I'm going to be doing like 20 years or something like that, you know. So I thought, yeah, my life couldn't get much worse, but really it was just beginning, my life was, yeah. And when I was in the court cells, I prayed with all the other girls in the cells for bail. I was like, but there was I was the only one that didn't get bail. Everyone else got bail, and I thought, oh, stuff you, God, you know. But really, he didn't answer my prayers, because that's where I needed to be, like what Shane was saying, you know, I actually needed to be there because I couldn't get out without being where I was. And I began to dig myself out of that hole that he was talking about and build a new life. The judge gave me a chance to attend Ngāti Hini Health Trust residential program, Te Hurihanga. It's in Waitangi. The judge said to me, because I had like 40 something other convictions for all meth related charges, he said, I don't think you can, I don't have any faith in you at all, but I'll give you the benefit of the doubt and I'll give you a chance. And to be honest, I still didn't think that I had a drug problem. I knew I had a problem, but the problem wasn't meth, it was the police. They stopped me from using. So they were my problem. And I loved meth so much, and I thought I'd use it until the day I died. And as long as I was high when I died, I'd be happy. You'll often hear a meth addict saying, meth till death, you know. So when I was released from prison, I was only ticking boxes, just telling everyone what they wanted to hear, manipulating people, the system and services, so I could get out of jail and just carry on using. My mindset was I'd use drugs and I'd take over the rehab, I'd get all the workers on it, everyone, and if I couldn't get them on it, I'd pay them with drug money so I could just carry on using. So I had no intention of getting clean. I didn't even know it was possible. I believe it is important to share all this stuff with you because it might help you understand why it's so difficult working with addicts, and it's simply because most of them don't even think that they've got a problem. When I finally entered into residential, it was 25th September 2018. It was so different. All these lovely people, they weren't on drugs. Most of them had never even tried drugs, and they couldn't be bought. I didn't even try, to be honest. But they just wanted what was best for me. Yeah, and I owe my life to these people. I owe my life to Ngāti Hine. But those people, they weren't my people. They were different. They didn't know how I felt, and they didn't know what it was like to be an addict. And this is where lived experience becomes parallel. One of the workers, who happens to be here today, Trev over there, I'll always remember his words. He said to me, I was sitting where you were 2 years ago, and now I've graduated and I'm working here. And he was actually a Pōwhānau connector. Yeah, he gave me hope and inspiration. After I graduated, Trev and Pam, they became my main support people. Getting clean was easy, but it was staying clean and learning to live. That's where the real work starts. I knew nothing else. Yeah, I was like, how am I going to get a job? No one's going to, no one's going to employ me. I've got like 90 convictions. Yeah. But then Pam and Trev continued to support me. I did my level 4, and eventually last year in March, I applied for the Pōwhānau connector job with Ngāti Hine, which I got, and I'm grateful for that. As I now feel like the whole 20 years that I was in addiction wasn't for nothing, because I can now use that in a positive way. My job's more than a job, it's like a lifestyle to me, it never stops. Yeah, I take phone calls on the weekends. I'll go and pick up one of my clients and be that one that sits in that NA meeting with them, like Lauren said, for the first time. I also facilitate in-house meeting, NA meeting at the residential program every fortnight. In my role, I can connect with most people on a deeper level than someone without lived experience. Yeah, it's a gift to be able to use lived experience to reach people. Sometimes, they're really hard to reach people because they could be in trouble with the police, or they've lost faith in the services. But when they hear me say that I've lived experience, some magic happens and their faces light up. Yeah, and they drop down some of their barriers. And I know a lot of the people that I work with because I was in addiction for so long, so that helps. They can connect and they trust me. And I've heard heaps of people say, you can't help someone that's not willing, and I don't see that. I think I can help everyone. Because no people's journey is the same. I came in kicking and screaming, fighting it all the way. Like, it took me 3 Pōwhiris to get in the door, and I hated it. I hated all the meetings, the programs. I hated everything about it. But the only other option I had was jail, and I hated that even more. Some other things I do in my job is I help the tangata whaeora and their whānau to navigate the many different services. We have many services within Ngāti Hine, but also at the outside agencies like OT, medical services, counselling, detox, MSD, corrections, lawyers, residential treatment programs or groups that they can attend, and all the people here. And lots of the time I know what they're thinking, I know what they're feeling, and I know before it even happens where they're going to go. I've had lots of highlights in my position, a lot of successes. One of my favourite things is helping the woman out of prison into treatment, because I've been there. I love that. Yeah, I love seeing them. And I especially like watching the ripple effect from one person getting clean. It creates hopes and inspirations to the others still actively using, and from one person using, like 10 people, or the whole family, or the whole community, will can follow. I'm super busy in my role. Yeah, we need more Pōwhānau connectors. And we run like a few programs at Ngāti Hine as well. We do a Toi Oranga program that's like art therapy, and I used to think, oh my gosh, art, how does that help? But I can't even draw a stick man. But watching the people come in and draw, their heart comes out on that paper, and there's some really powerful stories. Like one guy that he was in residential at the time, and he drew, I was having a bad day, and he drew all these swear words on one side of the paper, like violent swear words, and then he drew his heart, and then it's like filtered through his heart, and positive words come out the other side. Some really beautiful work comes with it. And we do a relapse prevention planning, and we also do tariatawa. Yeah, that's probably about it. I just want to acknowledge my mum for coming. She's been a massive part of my journey. None of my addiction has a reflection on my mum and dad's parenting because they were honestly the best parents in the world that you could ever, never ever ask for. My name is Anissa and I am a addict. But I'm a recovering addict for 5 years clean. Kia ora.
Thank you.